My uncle was a pilot. He used to take us up as kids flying in an old Cessna plane. Got my pilot's license, and I did some photography schooling. So as I was doing photography school and my pilot's license, I was just taking pictures out of the airplane, posting it onto a blog. And then one day I got a call from Parks Canada. They asked me to map an area, and I had no idea what that was. So I Googled it and found out that there is a market for aerial mapping.
So GreenLink in general, we create these maps so then our clients use them to create a DFMP, Detailed Forest Management Plan. The importance of the data that we provide to the companies is it's responsible land management. Like, our mandate is to represent the public.
We're doing a work for all most of the big mills here in the province, and they need to know what's out there as far as their inventory, their trees and stuff. So if they have a really accurate idea of exactly what's out there, they can plan what they're going to do this year, next year, and the following years.
So the client brings the area that they want to get mapped to GreenLink, and GreenLink creates the file for me to create a flight path. So I import that into my specialized flight planning software. I'll input the cameras that I'm using, the Fujifilms, and so it has the sensor size, and then I can calculate the flight track, and the flight lines will be calculated automatically. I'll tell it what altitude that I want to fly at for the resolution that they want to capture, and then it will input that data, and then I'll be able to figure out my flight time. And then once that's created, I'll put it onto a memory card, and then I'll import it into my survey equipment that ultimately triggers the cameras when I'm flying.
So the way aerial photography is measured is in something called ground sampling distance. So that just refers to that one pixel on the camera is equivalent to how large an area on the ground. So if I had a 3 centimeter ground sampling distance, that would mean each pixel on the camera is equivalent to 3 centimeters on the ground.
The max resolution we capture is 5 centimeters per pixel, and then we capture up to about 30 centimeters. Basically, if the client wants really high resolution imagery, we'll fly low, and if they don't need that, we'll fly at 16,000 feet. So the cameras I use are the GFX100S Fujifilm and the GFX100 near infrared. I choose to fly these because they have the medium format sensor, so you can get a lot of area in each image. That's the goal, is to get as large amount of area captured as we can, as quickly as we can, because we rely on the weather so much that we only have usually a short window of about 3 hours every morning before the clouds roll in. So I have 2 floor holes in the aircraft. I have one in the cargo bay, and that's for the RGB camera. And then I have one in the passenger seat. I'll take the passenger seat out and then mount the near-infrared camera. So there's one behind and then one in front. They each have their own cable that connects to the survey computer. There was a bit of a learning curve, how to power it in the aircraft, how to mount it. In the end, the Fujifilm, I was able to overcome these things and make these cameras work. They've shown to work out extremely well. So I have flight lines that I follow in the aircraft, and there's little dots on the screen that will turn from gray to green once it triggers the image. The cameras will trigger by GPS, and they're triggered at the exact same time. So that will allow us to overlay the two images to create a 4-band image, which gives them a lot of details and information, so they can actually take different spectrums, wavelengths, and they can eliminate some, they can add some to highlight certain spectrums of the wavelength that they need to see.
So the importance of the infrared spectrum is you can identify moistures better, species better, and whether it's And most commonly, we use the infrared for in the leaf-off environment because the conifer species pops out from any deciduous species much better.
I basically take the raw images, I import them into the computer, and I do a little bit of corrections to the color and exposure if it needs adjusting. And then I'll export the images into a TIFF format. And then once they're into TIFF, I'll use some special software to align the images. So there's an RGB image and then there's a near infrared image. So once it batch processes those TIFF files, I'll also do the GPS, so I have to match up each trigger event from my survey GPS. It has to match up to the image names, so everything has to be aligned for image names, and once that's done, I'll throw it onto a hard drive and pass it on to Tom at Greenlight.
What we're doing with Daryl is we are looking for pixels on one image that are represented in other pictures as well from different angles. So one spot on the ground, it might be photographed 5, 6, 7 times. As the plane's flying overhead, it'll, you know, from planes here and here, you take an image here, 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 here. And then when you do the next line in front, it's the same thing. It's taking the same point over and over again. We are basically pulling the imagery apart pixel by pixel, getting an exact X, Y, Z location for each pixel, and then we bring it all back together and make one giant image from it. So from that, we're also able to, because we know the location of each pixel, we can determine heights as well. Instead of it just being a flat image, we know we can see elevations. Once we generate the imagery, what I will give to the rest of our team here is we have what we call 3D models or 3D stereo pairs. So they will take the imagery, bring it onto their computer, and what they're doing is they're trying to map out the land base. So they will draw, they'll have the 3D imagery on their screen, they wear the funny goggles, and they'll map out every little area of land that is slightly different. So they'll base it on different species, the height of the trees, the ecosite that's out there. The imagery has just gotten so good now. We can get a lot of data from just the imagery, like not having to go out in the forest.
My passion is aviation and photography. And basically, this combines the two, which is pretty awesome. I can't say that too many people get to do what they love, and I definitely do what I love, so I'm pretty fortunate in that respect.